Hey there, it's been a while. Quite a while, actually. What's been new?
Sincerely, Velma.
Yeah, and of course.
That's what you like, huh? Oh, now you're on my blanket, bro.
Alrighty then. Okay, let's just go back to something that's a bit more familiar with this channel, Christian Media. If you aren't familiar with it, I did a video a few years back about the first anime I ever watched, The Flying House, which is about three siblings traveling back throughout biblical times to get back home. I thought it was pretty subpar with other shows utilizing the subject material better, and I was exposed to a lot of those shows growing up. There was quite a few films I remember watching as well. The Left Behind series, God's Not Dead, Revelation, which is hands down the most frightening Christian movie in existence. I remember having nightmares about this movie when I was younger. However, there was one movie that has been etched into my memory, and that's the topic of this video, War Room, made by these guys, Alec and Stephen Kendrick under their production company, Kendrick Brothers. Taking a quick scroll through their website, it's clearly evident what their goals are with their movies, with their mission statement saying, "We exist to honor Jesus Christ and make his truth and love known among the nations through movies, books, curriculum, and speaking. By prayerfully blending engaging stories with doctrinal integrity, we seek to encourage and inspire viewers and readers with resources that impact their spiritual lives and strengthen their families and personal relationships." Keep this last part in mind, as it is interesting to see what they consider strengthening relationships. Anyways, let's dive right into this mess. The movie starts with narration from one of our leading characters, Miss Claire, about how fucked up the world is.
War. It's been a part of humanity in every age. We fight for power, for riches, for rights, or for freedom.
Seems like this talking point is brought up a lot in these movies to show how Christianity and Jesus are the answer to these problems. But this time, I can see how it's justified, not only because war is in the title, of course, but also Miss Claire's husband, Leo, was a battle strategist in the army, tying into the main theme of the story of how a battle strategy is required to face any obstacle throughout life, more specifically, marriage problems. We are then introduced to our married couple in question, Elizabeth, who's a retailer, and Tony, who works in pharmaceutical sales. But something might be heating up between our lead man and a worker contact.
I'll be your contact for the purchase.
Okay, well, Veronica Drake, I guess I'll be seeing you again when I return in 2 weeks.
I look forward to it.
Back at home, their daughter Danielle is afraid that Tony will be mad at her report card.
Oh, baby, you have an A in everything else. One C in math is not that bad.
Is that your feet?
I'm sorry, baby. I ran out of foot powder.
So you decide to touch the report card and Danielle with your foot rubbing hand? You don't even wash your hands first? Just nasty. While I'm at it, I'm just gonna put this little thing in the corner. Tony arrives home in a bit of a sour mood because Elizabeth took money from their checking account for her sister.
I got my last report card. I made all A's except for one C.
So I just got a notification that you moved $5,000 from our savings into your checking account. That better not be so you can prop up your sister again.
You just gave that much money to your family last month.
My parents are elderly. Okay, your sister married a bum, and I'm not supporting someone who's too lazy to work. But if you want to give them what you make, that's fine. But you're not giving them my money.
Your money? The last time I checked, we both put money into that account.
And the last time I checked, I make four times what you do.
So I know the scene is played out as if Tony's the one in the wrong. He's completely ignoring Danielle, being abrasive, his tone is just loud, but for the latter, he has a right to be angry. If Darren isn't being proactive and finding himself a job, he can be angry about continuously lending money to them, especially if Darren has shown no sign of trying to find a job, which Elizabeth denies, by the way.
Darren is not a bum. He's just having a hard time finding a job.
I will remember this conversation.
With Tony just about having it, he decides to take his frustrations out in the gym, throwing down some
"in your face disgrace,"
which catches his friend Michael by surprise, who's that one guy who can't help but say something about God in every other sentence.
Dude, I can't get a pass from you. It'd be easier to baptize a cat. I just need you to blow off a little sentence, okay?
Yo, you coming to church, right?
Maybe.
Maybe means no.
For the next scenes, it shows the conflict that Tony and Elizabeth have with each other, mostly regarding Tony being thirsty over women in church, being away from work too often.
I'm out of town this week.
When were you going to tell me?
I just did.
Tony, I know you're the company's top salesman, but in order for this family to function, we have to communicate.
Or not caring about Danielle's hobbies.
I thought you were playing basketball. Aren't you a little too old to be jumping rope?
This brings me back to what Miss Claire said at the beginning of the film.
Very few of us know how to fight the right way or understand who we're really fighting against.
And I can't possibly figure out who else Elizabeth should be fighting against besides Tony. So far, he's shown to be the reason for the issues with the relationship. But hey, we've just started, so maybe it'll make sense later on. We then cut to Elizabeth meeting with Miss Claire to discuss selling the house as she describes each of the rooms, with Elizabeth accidentally spilling about her messy situation at home after seeing all the answered prayers that Miss Claire has.
I look back on it, and I'm reminded that God is still in control. It encourages me.
I sure could use some of that.
It catches the attention of Miss Claire, and she seems to have something big in store for her next meeting.
By the way, what's your most favorite room?
I'll tell you tomorrow.
And I'll look forward to tomorrow.
Elizabeth decides to have a discussion with her co-workers about Tony and the situation with her sisters.
And he thinks it's my sister's fault. Can you even believe that?
You do not want World War III to break out in your home.
No, I don't. But there are days, Mandy. There are days. It's hard to submit to a man like that.
Number one, if Darren was shown to be a bum before she married him, it's absolutely her fault that she's in the situation she's in, knowing full well that he wouldn't be able to support her. And number two, what do you mean by it's hard to submit to a man like that? Someone who's trying to be financially responsible and not constantly give money out? One of the co-workers responds with,
"Sometimes submission is learning to duck so God can hit your husband."
The question is, how long is she going to be ducking until some sense is knocked into Tony? Because he's starting to make the moves on Veronica and decides to call her up for a dinner date.
Hey, listen, I'll be coming through town next week and I was wondering if you could recommend a couple of nice restaurants. Feel free to call me back at this number. Take care.
Shame on you. For shame.
We go to the next day where Miss Claire is trying to get into Elizabeth's personal life as she tries to show the asking prices for her house.
And you have children?
Miss Clara, my husband Tony and I have been married for 16 years. We have one daughter, her name is Danielle, and she's 10. She enjoys pop music and ice cream and jumping rope.
Now, what did you say your husband did for a living?
Well, we actually haven't talked about that.
Now, you say you attend church occasionally. Is that because your pastor only preaches occasionally?
Bitch!
What your prayer life was like. Would you say that it was hot or cold?
I'm not hot, but I'm not cold either. Just, you know, somewhere in the middle. Miss Clara, you like your coffee room temperature?
No, baby, mine's hot.
But I'll have some lukewarm coffee just sitting around so I can do a gotcha for my unholy guests. If she would have said that her prayer life was cold, would she have put ice cubes in her coffee? Like, I'm asking legitimately. After Elizabeth asks why Miss Clara keeps examining her life, she replies with,
"Because I've been where you are."
How exactly do you know what she's going through? The only thing Elizabeth said the day prior to give you any indication of her troubles in her life was that she needed some encouragement like you were given with your answered prayers. But you decided to make a beeline dash to her husband's gotta be fucking shit up. So how exactly did you come to that conclusion? Especially with the answers that she provided you. Miss Claire then shows Elizabeth her favorite room, her war room, and discusses how she dealt with her own marriage problems with the prayer strategy, where one gives a responsibility to God to solve their problems by praying, which results in becoming more connected with God as he will be doing the heavy lifting.
Now, I used to do what you and your husband are doing, but it got me nowhere. And then I really started studying what the scriptures say. And God showed me that it wasn't my job to do the heavy lifting, no. That was something that only he could do.
How does he do it? I don't know. And neither does Elizabeth. So she agrees to meet with Miss Claire 1 hour a week to learn more about it.
Don't let me push too hard, Lord. I know I got a big mouth.
You don't say! In the next scene, we hear Danielle and her friend Jennifer talking about each other's parents. And while Jennifer seemed fun and lighthearted, Danielle doesn't seem to have the same view on hers.
Breathe. It was hilarious.
I wish I lived at your house. Whenever my parents are together, they just fight.
Jennifer, how's your family?
Fine.
Would you like to stay for dinner? You're welcome to eat with us.
Okay.
Now, after hearing her daughter say how much she doesn't like her parents, what do you think Elizabeth ends up doing? Did you say that she would act more like a child than the two children sitting next to her at the dinner table? No? Well, she does exactly that. I understand it's supposed to be a joke, but why the fuck would you put this scene right after the one before? It completely ruins any tension or emotion that was starting to build up. It wasn't even necessary, because the very next scene is back to being serious.
You know we love you, right? That wasn't very convincing.
Well, I think you love me a little bit. What's my team name?
The Firecrackers.
That was last year. What jump rope trick did I just learn to do? What award did I win last week on my team?
You won an award last week?
I really can't take this seriously, and it's not just because of the previous scene. It really feels like a forced emotional moment that just had to happen. But maybe the movie is onto something here, showing that Tony isn't the only one at fault, as both him and Elizabeth have neglected Danielle. So maybe some ownership or responsibility might come? The next day, Elizabeth goes to Miss Claire's to explain what had happened the night before.
Her heart is just breaking, and I was completely unaware. Tony! He's completely unaware. He's off in his own world, being top salesman somewhere, while his daughter is growing more and more callous to him every day.
Honestly, in this situation, you look worse because you and Tony basically have the same knowledge of your own daughter's extracurricular activities, which is very little. Yet he's away way more often than you. You didn't even know Danielle won an award the week prior, so all this huffing and puffing directed towards Tony needs to be on you too, because you both were completely unaware. But as soon as she brings up Tony being flirtatious to women, which is something that probably should be addressed, Miss Claire stops her.
Women that just Elizabeth, just so I know, how much of the 1 hour we got together today are you going to spend whining about your husband, and how much we going to spend on what the Lord can do about it?
But you can do something right now about him being flirtatious with women by addressing it. And not just sweeping it under the rug, hoping that God will fix it.
He acts like an enemy to me.
See, you're fighting the wrong enemy. Now, your husband certainly has his issues, but he's not your enemy.
Oh my gosh, the fact that this shit came out of her mouth just baffles me beyond human proportions. What do you mean Tony is not the real enemy she's fighting? The conflict that's happening right now is the result of the arguing and fighting between Tony and Elizabeth. Who else's fault is it?
Now, I tried for years to fix Leo, but I couldn't do it.
Well, I haven't got anywhere with Tony.
'Cause it's not your job. Who said that it was your responsibility to fix Tony? It's your job to love him, to respect him, and to pray for the man.
It's very hard to do that when he's making googly eyes at other women in church, literally right next to her. So what happens if things escalate to the point of being physical? What then? But hey, that's your job as his wife, right? To love him even through the rough blemishes?
You got to plead with God so that he can do what only he can do.
Yes, only God can fix Tony. Marriage counselors, you say?
No.
Their spiritual levels will never be maxed up to deal with these kind of problems because they'll always be attached to the moolah. God is free, baby.
Good Lord is going down on me.
To get Elizabeth started with her prayer journey, she gives her a couple of her favorite scriptures to study over. Then we get ourselves a war room preparation montage. Praise the Lord! I find it funny how some of the lyrics of the song are "You're about to break loose" as she proceeds to clean out her closet to lock herself in? Or so we thought, as she doesn't have any discipline in prayer, giving us this hilarious scene about eating chips in the closet.
Mom, are you okay?
Yes, what do you need?
Why are you eating chips in the closet?
I'm just having some private time, okay? Don't tell anybody I was eating chips in this closet.
Don't tell anyone my mom was eating chips in the closet, okay?
Who are you talking to?
Jennifer.
Jennifer? I'm asking you not to tell anybody I was eating chips in my closet.
Okay.
If anything should be kept under wraps, is that your own daughter wishes she could live at another family's house. Get your fucking priorities straight, woman.
What's that smell?
That would be my shoes, Jennifer. And if you girls would kindly shut the door, you won't have to smell it anymore.
Is she not allowed to eat chips?
I can have all the chips I want. This is my house.
Meanwhile, Tony just got a bonus at work for securing an important account. And here's our director of this movie, Alex Kendrick, making an appearance as Tony's boss.
We just wanted to say thanks. And you got a nice bonus check coming your way.
I like that.
Yeah, you do. How's Elizabeth?
She's good.
Tell her I said hello.
We then move to him arriving home as Elizabeth is having a conversation with her sister on the phone about Darren. And it seems like she isn't doing anything to find a job.
He's making it hard, not just on you, but everybody around you. No, I'm not saying that we're not going to help. We're still talking about it, okay?
I take it that was your sister, Darren, getting a job?
Not yet.
Not yet as in he's trying, or not yet as in he's still sitting on the couch playing video games?
Tony, what he does is not Cynthia's fault.
Cynthia married a loser, okay? That was her choice. When everybody told her not to, it is her fault.
Tony, she cannot control him. She's got a job, but it's not enough.
This movie has such a habit of shifting responsibility and blame all over the place that it's nauseating to my stomach. We understand that she can't control Derek's actions, but what she can control is who she ends up marrying. If all the signs are there that he'll not financially support you, with your family and friends also acknowledging this, it's all on you on what ends up happening if you do proceed to marry him. His behavior does not control your free will. So again, Tony has every right to be angry, especially now that we know for sure that Darren isn't doing jack shit.
I'm asking for 1 month's rent and a car payment.
And the next month you'll be asking for the same thing, Liz. So the answer is still no. And what is that smell in here?
I'm putting powder in my shoes.
Well, can't you do that outside?
Tony. If you won't do it for her, do it for me.
No.
We then go to one of the few tolerable scenes in this movie, with Michael confronting Tony about his issues with Elizabeth, sparking off actual helpful insight.
Dude, you remember that one lady who had swallowed that garlic and she choked and had to give her mouth to mouth?
Couldn't have done it.
Yeah, you could do it. You're not just gonna let somebody die in front of you while you eat your salad.
Yo, what if it was your wife? Hold on, bro. What? What's that?
Mike, I'm just tired of her, okay? All right, I said it. I'm just tired of her junk.
Dude, you married her junk and all. It's not like some sort of buffet where you get to pick and choose what you want. You get all of her, bro. And you better not have somebody on the side.
So you're trying to do CPR on my personal life now?
Yeah, I'm a paramedic, but I'm also a Christian, which means I help people while I'm helping people. And since we've been friends a long time, I'm not just gonna watch your marriage die.
However, it does feel a little bit contrived, like the only reason that Michael is a paramedic is for this conversation to happen. The turning point where Tony gets addressed head on about what he's doing. Same thing with seeing Tony getting that raise for this conversation to even begin.
You got another bonus?
Yes, sir. Dude, I went in the wrong line of work.
So I'll give the movie partial credit, okay? At this point, I'm taking the littlest I can get. And the next scene starts off all right as well, with Elizabeth wondering how she could have raised Danielle better instead of trying to chase her career.
You know, there are days I wish she had a brother or sister. We were just too busy chasing our careers. I don't know that that was a wise thing to do.
You don't enjoy your job?
Oh, there are days I do. Sold the house this morning, so that was good. I'd just rather have a good marriage than more money.
It's refreshing to hear what she could have done differently instead of just putting it all on Tony, considering what we know now. Man, I love to see some accountability. However, the scene following... after sending Danielle to get some heart attack inducing ice cream.
Can I have strawberry sherbet with gummy worms and chocolate syrup on top?
Ugh. Yeah, I'm with you. What the fuck is that combination? Elizabeth and Miss Claire go to their car to pick her up when this happens.
I used to spend so much time with my girlfriends before my job.
Give me your money right now. Do it and do it now.
No. Now you put that knife down right now in the name of Jesus.
And you believe he was early 20s?
Yeah.
Now, I'm aware that a robber may be startled by someone with a commanding voice, but this is overdoing it. The guy's reaction was like he was being mind controlled on some preacher shit. Just look at his face. The way this is set up was as if her saying Jesus' name made him drop the knife, which is enforced shortly after.
So let me get this straight. He was pointing a knife at you, and you told him to put it down in Jesus' name.
Right. Now, when you write that down, don't leave out Jesus. People always leaving Jesus out. That's one of the reasons we're in the mess we're in.
What are you talking about?
And this brings up a big glaring question. Why hasn't she tried this on Tony yet? Because it seems like she cast out whatever was possessing this guy to rob them, so why can't the same be done for Tony and his behavior? There is literally no reason why she can't try. And the excuse of,
men don't like it when their women's always trying to fix them,
is completely null and void when she's clearly been all into his with Elizabeth up to this point. We then go to Miss Claire's place where she tells Elizabeth to write down everything that Tony has done bad to her, which she comes up with quite the list. But she doesn't care about anything she wrote down, rather she believes that Tony deserves grace for what he's done because of this explanation.
The Bible says that no one is righteous, not even one, for we have all sinned. So really none of us deserve grace.
But not all sin carries the same weight, you old dense motherfucker. Being overweight and unhealthy is considered a sin, but there's no way I would put it near the same level as adultery. We haven't even seen Elizabeth sin at any point in this movie thus far, only Tony. But yet, he's the one who deserves grace?
The Bible also says that we can't ask him to forgive us while refusing to forgive others.
This is just taking accountability away from Tony to change and putting it all on Elizabeth to forgive him, show him grace, when he repeatedly makes the same bad choices. I don't get that at all. Where is that line drawn? And when Elizabeth brings up the possibility of Tony continuously walking all over her, Miss Claire responds with,
God is a good defense attorney. Trust it to him. And then you can turn your focus to the real enemy.
The real enemy?
The one that wants to remain hidden. Satan comes to steal, kill, and destroy. And he is stealing your joy. He is killing your faith. And he's trying to destroy your family.
So the real enemy that Miss Claire was referring to at the beginning that people should be fighting against is Satan. Ah man, this movie just took a massive nosedive. Like it wasn't already steadily declining. Apparently, Satan is the one who's behind Elizabeth's marriage fallout, not the one who is the main cause of all of this strife she's dealing with.
Nope.
It's all Satan's fault. The guy who was robbing you too early was probably possessed by him as well. And if that's the case, it only gives more reasoning for Miss Claire to try to cast him out of Tony. But where's the fun in that? Elizabeth has a prayer room waiting for her to be organized and prepared for battle. During this, we hear Miss Claire saying that she should pray for those that the Lord brings to mind.
Pray for the heart of your husband, your daughter, and anyone else that the Lord brings to your mind.
Can't you take your own advice? Why don't you pray for her, her husband, her family to lead them to prayer and unity? Why go through all this extraneous bullshit? As soon as Elizabeth finishes her prayer preparation, she has sent this text message from her friend. Now, it's time to buckle down and get serious. She proceeds to go into prayer mode for God to steer Tony back into her arms and protect her marriage, ending with a scripture from James 4:7.
Lord, I've been so angry at Tony. And I am still so angry at him. but I don't want to lose my marriage. Please, don't let him do this. He's doing something wrong. Don't let him get away with it. Stand in his way. Submit to God. Resist the devil. And he will flee.
Elizabeth then wants to have a one-on-one with the real enemy, the devil, in a shouting match.
You have played with my mind and had your way long enough. No more. Jesus is the Lord of this house. And that means there's no place for you here anymore. So take your lies, your schemes, and your accusations and get out.
I find it funny how she's putting more energy and effort into arguing with the devil, whom she can't even see or know where he is, than she ever did with Tony. Maybe if she had the same conviction here with him, you can address the problem straight up and see some changes, but...
Nope.
Meanwhile, at the restaurant, Veronica is trying to seal the deal with Tony to have some intimate loving.
You know what I really like right now? A glass of my favorite wine.
What is it?
It's not here. It's at my apartment.
You slut!
Goddamn whore!
No!
Oh, whoa! When all of a sudden, Tony starts to feel sick, to the point of throwing up as if Elizabeth's chastisement of the devil caused it. But why? Just a little bit ago, she read that you must submit to God, resist the devil, and then he'll flee, both of which Tony is not doing. So why is the real enemy releasing his grips from Tony? He was a couple of glasses away from slamming into Veronica until kingdom come. And the added context of the scripture makes this scene even more confusing. Does the grace that Miss Clay refers to apply to this instance as well, considering Tony was going to do it? And to be honest, she probably would say yes, there's no question about it. This is just all over the damn fucking place. And the only way to not notice it is to not think about it. But I can't not think when I'm watching a movie. Back at home, after being awakened by her mother's loud outburst, Danielle comes across her war room and Elizabeth sits her down to explain what it is.
I'm learning how to pray and fight.
You're fighting God?
No, I'm not. Well, sometimes I do fight God, but I shouldn't.
You were not fighting against God. Where did this come from? If anyone is fighting against God, it's Tony, as it says in the Bible.
So I'm learning how not to fight God and how to let him fight for me so that we can all win. Does that make any sense?
No.
Thank you!
We are then treated to another montage scene, but this time with Danielle starting to do the same practices as Elizabeth, such as prayer requests.
Now see, you're already influencing your daughter. This can change everything for her.
I can't believe I'm saying this, but Miss Claire is right. Yes, this can indeed change everything for her, because she is being taught how to confine herself in a closet for hours, hoping a higher entity will deliver her instead of addressing problems, because prayer always works. Because God rocks! It's the next morning and Liz ended up falling asleep in her prayer closet and is delivered two journals for herself and Danielle to use for writing down prayers and scriptures.
I just need you to sign for this package.
Oh, thank you so much.
Smell like Betsy here!
It's a present for my daughter. I can't wait to give it to her.
Well, I hope it takes your breath away.
That actually is pretty funny.
I like it. And you got one too.
Yep, I sure did. You can write your prayer requests in there, your favorite verses. We can journal, anything we want.
Hey, Daddy.
Hey, Daniel.
Hey, I didn't think you were coming home till tonight.
Yeah, I finished up everything pretty early, so.
So, it's established that he didn't go back to have sex with Veronica after puking his brains out, so that prayer definitely did work and does contradict the scripture. But oh, what the heck. As Tony is putting his stuff away, Elizabeth's phone rings and Tony wants to know who she's been talking with, taking the opportunity as Jennifer's mother comes to pick Danielle up.
Hey, I'm good. How are you? You and the girls hanging out today?
Yeah, we're gonna go to the park for a couple hours and then I thought we could grab a milkshake at Chick-fil-A if that's okay?
Of course it's okay to get some Chick-fil-A. Their milkshakes are A-tier, the best customer service, and most importantly, it's a Christian-led establishment! On a more serious note, Tony finds out that Elizabeth knows about his little shindig with Veronica, and now he's gotta be on guard.
So what's been going on here?
Well, I sold another house on Tuesday, and I already told you about getting held up, so.
About that. It's not that I didn't care. I just got really busy.
I understand. It's all right. I'm sorry for getting so worked up about it.
You're sorry.
Even Tony is surprised about how forgiving she is, to the point where he switches place with her in fear of getting poisoned, because she is way too calm for someone to know that her husband is potentially slanging with other women. Tony finally asks her,
"What do you want, Liz?"
"Well, I would kill for a hot fudge sundae, whipped cream, just mounds of whipped cream on top. And my feet are killing me. Man, I would love a foot rub."
Of course, she doesn't say what she truly wants, as she is letting God do all the work. But you know you can do something besides pray, right? Just straight up tell him, "I want my marriage to be better and for you to stop going with other women," and take it from there. But nah, she needs that ice cream and foot rub to drown her sorrows while God is getting to work on Tony. We then see one of Tony's bosses finding out that he's been fudging his sales numbers.
"Tony's inventory is off, Rick. We saw the same thing last week when he left Asheville. He may just be padding numbers, but there's a pattern here."
Jeez, Tony is sinning left and right. What other dubious deeds has this man done?
The world may never know.
But remember, everybody deserves grace. So who cares what he's done? Tony is fired swiftly and is very angry about being caught with his schemes. However, Elizabeth isn't and tries to make the best of the situation.
"Tony, I think we'll be fine."
"Liz, you heard me, right? I just got fired, okay? So that means no income, no company car, no health coverage. We can't even afford this house anymore."
"I'll just pick up some new properties while you look for a different job, okay?"
I still don't think that would help you, because like Tony said towards the beginning of the film,
"The last time I checked, I make four times what you do."
So maybe you should take this situation a bit less nonchalantly and with some seriousness, because him losing his job greatly affects you. The next scene, Tony has a dream of a figure in a hooded jacket beating up on Elizabeth. But who could this mysterious figure be? It's Tony? Who would have fucking guessed?
Me!
The dream ends with Tony getting the lights knocked out of him. Startled from his dream, Tony does the only thing he knows can calm his nerves. That's right, baby, the gym. Pumping iron, getting those muscles into peak perfection. But first, he needs to find his gym bag.
"Danielle, you seen my gym bag?"
"No, sir."
It's funny how the second time they cut to Danielle before she says her line, she puts down the honeycombs to display them. Probably the only reason why this scene exists. But as long as you got that sweet product placement in, right? The budget does not pay for itself. While still searching, Tony finds Elizabeth's war room.
"Lord, I pray for Tony that you would turn his heart back to you."
Was his heart ever turned to God? Throughout the whole movie, all we've seen is Tony sinning left and right in everything he does. Even in church, the one place where you would expect to rein in your horniness, which they only occasionally go anyways, right in front of his wife and daughter. He did not give a single fuck about being in line with the Lord. After Danielle finds his gym bag, Tony heads off to tell Michael about his recent discovery, with Michael emphasizing how Elizabeth having God on her side is a losing battle.
"All I know is you can fight against your wife and probably hold your own. But if God is fighting for her, you can hit the gym all you want to, bro. It's not looking good for you."
Yeah, apparently, since it'll result in you having stomach pains in the most cliche dream sequence known to mankind. Tony decides to pick up Danielle later from her double dutch practice in order to examine Elizabeth's war room more and to really reflect on his life up to this point. Seeing all of the prayers for him and the pictures of his family is enough to break him down. The next thing you know, he's on his knees finally admitting the truth.
"Jesus, I'm not a good man. I'm prideful and I'm hurting this family. I don't like the man I've become. But I don't know how to fix it." "Forgive me, Jesus.
This moment is just cheap because his transition from an ultra sinner to surrendering to God happens in a matter of minutes. It feels very rushed and doesn't have the impact it thinks it has. If all he needed to see was some family pictures and prayers for him to finally change, what was the purpose of doing all the secret praying in the war room? This scene wouldn't have happened if he didn't find the room, so why try to hide all this concern you have for someone instead of being upfront about it? Unless you're telling me that God misplaced Tony's bag so he can find the room, and all I have to say to that is the quickest way from point A to B is a straight line. Stop going all over the place, just hit it straight on. So now Tony is showing interest in Danielle and her double dutching, which of course he is. He's a God-fearing man now.
Hey, you know what? I thought your jump rope routine was gonna be something simple, but it wasn't. Really good.
Thanks.
Doesn't stop his car from being repossessed by his company, though. We are then given yet another very emotional, hard-hitting scene, with Tony confronting Elizabeth about why she's still staying with him, even though she knew that he was with another woman.
I almost cheated on you, Liz. But you know all this. And you're still here. Then I see your closet. And the way you're praying for me. Why would you do that?
Because I'm not done with us. But I am his before I'm yours. And because I love Jesus, I'm staying right here.
Oh boy. Because she loves Jesus, she still would have been with Tony if he didn't change. Which is really concerning, considering he was one gym bag find away from being the same old Tony but just a startling dream.
I forgive you.
What a shocker. When she tells Miss Claire about it, she goes into full-on worshiping mode by the news, praising the Lord for beating the devil.
See, I told you, Elizabeth. I told you that God would fight for you. Oh, devil, you just got your butt kicked. My God is powerful, and my God is in charge.
Anything is possible with Jesus on our team.
The next scene shows Tony asking for Danielle's forgiveness for being a terrible father.
I can do better, Danielle. You both deserve better from me. I wanted to ask you if you would forgive me and give me another chance. Listen, I do love you, Danielle.
I love you too, Daddy.
They proceed to do some double dutch practice as Tony will be on Danielle and Jennifer's team for the freestyle competition. Look at the moves. However, there are still some lingering issues from work that Tony must deal with.
Where did you get these?
I've been keeping some for myself each time I take samples to a client.
I thought they had to sign for what you gave them.
There's ways around it, Liz.
So to top everything off of what Tony has done wrong in this movie, he was stealing. Any other of the Ten Commandments you've broken that you want to confess while you're at it?
Tony, you gotta take these back.
Liz, I could be prosecuted for this. Look, I've already lost my job. All right, so now I'm supposed to go and tell Danielle her daddy might be going to jail?
Then why are you struggling?
Did I miss something? What does she mean, why is he struggling? He just told you why he was. I've watched this scene a couple of times to see what else she could have meant, and I can't for the life of me figure it out. And isn't it funny that throughout this whole movie, she's been fighting to keep her marriage intact, only for Tony to put himself in a situation where he could be going to jail for years.
Ironic.
The next scene, we see Tony go into Coleman and Tom to give back the prescriptions he's been stashing, but Tony grilling him justifiably.
We give you a high salary with awards and benefits and trips, and you decide to thank us by taking even more for yourself? Do you realize we could have you prosecuted for this, Tom?
But it seems like Coleman is showing some mercy as he is giving him 2 days until he's made his decision of whether he'll prosecute or not.
Tony, are you willing to sign a statement?
I am.
And I want 2 days to think about it.
2 days?
Yes. You'll hear from me by then.
Man, I really wonder what he's going to do. I can't put my finger on it. Now it's just a waiting and praying game for the next 2 days. So you know what that means. another montage, but this time it's with Crazy Faye. Why even show up this last shot? Like, it's really a toss-up of what he's going to do. Ah, man, I'm on the edge of my seat just waiting for this moment. Coleman actually decides to come to their house to give Tony and Elizabeth the news.
I've never seen a man take total responsibility for his wrongdoing, no matter the consequence. And I kept asking myself, why? Why would you do that? The only answer I can come up with is that you were sincere in your desire to make it right, and that you regret what you've done. I can't give you your job back, but I've decided not to prosecute. I do think it would be appropriate to return the $19,000 back to the company.
Hey, we've already decided to do that.
Very good. So if you don't mind me seeing myself out, I'll give you your evening back.
Tony, that was grace. That was God's grace toward us.
God is good all the time, and all the time, God is good. And the goodness keeps on rolling in as Elizabeth found a couple to buy Miss Claire's house. Remember that plot line? So guess what sold them on the house? Take a wild guess. The husband was a pastor for 35 years, and he sensed the strong prayer energy in Miss Claire's closet.
Someone's been praying in this closet.
That's right. That was her prayer closet. How did you know that?
It's almost like it's baked in.
Yep, they went that route with it. And I can't say I'm surprised. I wouldn't expect nothing less at this point. When Elizabeth goes to tell Miss Claire that her house has been sold, she somehow already knows about it.
Okay, I got some good news for you.
You gonna tell me that a retired pastor from Texas and his wife want to buy my house?
Now see, that's the kind of relationship with God I want. What did he say?
Well, it was actually your daughter. She texted me on my new smartphone on the way over here.
Okay, I'll give the movie that. It was a decent joke as it plays with the expectations set previously with her spiritual connection to God, and also calling back to when Miss Claire said she wanted a cell phone for herself.
Oh, you got one of those smartphones. I've been meaning to get me one of those. Can't do nothing with my phone but call folks. Must be a dumb phone.
After getting two hot cups of coffee, another callback, Miss Claire says that their future get-togethers can't be just them, but with other wives who are struggling.
You need to find a young woman to invest in. We all need help every now and then.
Yeah, but it's not the help that you're giving. Then the big reveal happens. Miss Claire says that she didn't end on good terms with Leo, and that she wished she prayed more for him. Because of this, she prayed to God to send her someone she can teach the ways of how to really fight. I don't understand why people are so late to using prayer in this movie. Apparently, it can do no wrong, control people, and totally change their outlook on life. So you would expect that more people would be seeing the effects that prayer has. And why even go through the trouble of finding lost wives to teach them? If you see a couple in public bickering and fighting, just go to your war room and pray for them and everything will be fine, as we've been shown. And it doesn't matter if they've surrendered to the Lord or not, as we've seen prayer worked on Tony, and he was backstabbing his way straight to hell with all the shit he was doing. And why is there still 20 plus minutes left? What else needs to be said? Oh wait, that's right. The double dutch competition plot line. We still need to tie that up into a nice little bow now, don't we? On their way to the competition, Elizabeth spots Tony with a flat tire. What are the odds? And Tony, being the good Christian man he is now, decides to help him replace his tire.
Why did you do that?
Because
because that's how I want to be treated, Danielle.
You just want every little point, don't you, movie? Anyways, competition time. And they're actually using a non-gospel song for this segment because it's all over. The journey has ended and the devil has been defeated because there is no such thing as impossible. That's cool and all, but there's only one song that I'll accept to be played during a double dutch competition. And my limit is definitely being pushed because this movie is still not over.
You maniac! Darn you!
Now you're probably wondering to yourself, what else is there left to be said? Their marriage is back together. Tony came clean about the prescriptions. Miss Claire's house was sold. Danielle got second place at the competition. Hell, even Tom was butt up again. So,
what the fuck is this?
Remember earlier in the movie when Tony asked Elizabeth what she wanted from him?
Well, I would kill for a hot fudge sundae.
Well, the movie spends 4 minutes to give that shit a nice ending too.
This is for the woman I don't deserve.
Really? Are you really doing this for me?
Yeah, come on
now. No, Tony. I don't want you to smell my feet.
Hey, look. I told you, I got this. I'm ready to go.
I'm eating my favorite dessert while my husband is rubbing my feet. There has got to be a God in heaven.
Just fuck off. We have finally reached the end of the movie, with Miss Claire signing us off with a powerful prayer, asking God to bring people for her to help and guide people to his word.
Give me another one, Lord. Guide me to who you want me to help. I pray for your hand of protection and guidance. Raise up a generation, Lord, that will take light into this world, that will not compromise when under pressure.
What do you mean by that?
Raise them up, Lord, that they will proclaim that there is salvation in the name of Jesus Christ. I pray these things with all my heart. Raise them up, Lord, raise them up.
And world peace was achieved and nothing ever went wrong again. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Well, it's over. I made it through the whole thing, and what a time it's been that I'll never get back. But I just had so much to say on the story being raw sewer shit, like the plethora of Christian movies out there. Very disingenuous to how things would play out in the real world. Because if they did take that into consideration, things wouldn't always go right for the people who convert to Christianity, because that's just the way life works, put it bluntly. But why would the people making this movie show that? We've seen what the purpose of all the Kendrick's productions are. They don't have any intent to make a good story. As long as people come out of the theater being the new servants of God, they see that as a win. And if that didn't happen, they sure enjoyed those box office numbers, sporting off $74 million worldwide against a $3 million budget? That is madly impressive. Well done, boys. Anyways, I think it's time to wrap up this video. I am done talking about War Room for the time being. I appreciate that you stayed throughout the whole video, and if you just skipped to this part, it's still cool that you even clicked on my video to begin with. If you enjoyed, consider leaving a like and a comment, sharing it with a buddy, and subscribe for more future content because I'm back, baby! I'm back! Merry Christmas, happy holidays, and a happy new year.